Did you fly over from Germany?
Yes, on Saturday.
On Saturday, so the jet lag is terrible still.
Yeah, well, it's good that you get up early, which is difficult for me usually.
So here it seems like you're very early.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I just came back from baking this morning.
Oh.
So your jet lag is nothing compared to mine.
I'm sure it is nothing.
Wow. I'm happy to let you two fight this competition out. I don't know.
Just jet lags from opposite directions.
Yeah. I only have jet lag from watching the Winter Olympics too late at night.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
So, anyway, on schedule, Emma is going to spend more time tomorrow with you.
She's
in charge.
Yes, I'm very interested.
Good. We're going to have to show you our new program and talk to you about the work you do.
Heidi's also have been doing some celebration of pointing to measurement and swallowing match in the box. Yeah, so we should probably find time So what they can do is probably tomorrow just
making sure his phone's on silent.
Yeah.
It's very popular.
It's
very popular.
Well, yeah.
So, tomorrow maybe you can spend
time
with us. To hang out with us.
Just hang out and the problem.
I'm going to stay here until Friday actually because I wanted to also see the Smithsonian and things like that. Never been here before.
Oh, fantastic.
But there's plenty of time. Yeah.
how
in case. On Friday, I'm leaving in the afternoon.
Oh, okay.
So
well,
the plane takes off at 6, I think.
Okay, well, if you have any interest in seeing behind the scenes of the sciences, I'm a research associate there.
Well, good morning, welcome, and it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Heidi Hoff, and she's an expert on probe analysis and particularly ferrous iron measurements as well as some light element measurements, and we have a relatively new probes, and I think we can learn a lot from her, and she's also interested in how to apply to not only natural sample as well as experiment charts. And she's going to spend a little bit of time with us today and tomorrow. And anyone is interested in talk to her after the seminar, and let me know. And Heidi is from Goethe University, from Frankfurt, and she has been working in the petroleum geochemistry group and for many, many years, and she has one of the particular things. I'm pretty sure you're going to talk about Frank method, and which how to optimize and using the probe to analyze ferric ion content, and I'll let you explain what you do, and thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you very much for the invitation. I'm going to talk about the determination of the iron oxidation state by electron microprobe. We call it the Flank method, and its application to high pressure experiments and to rock samples. In the first part of my talk, I will give an overview over the Flank method, give some basics about the, something got lost here, about the difference in ferric iron determination by electron microprobe and the normal elemental analysis in the electron microprobe. I will show how we develop the method for garnets and why the effect of self-absorption is so important. Then I will show the calibration of the Flank method with synthetic and natural garnets. In the second part of my talk, I will give a few examples about applications of the Flank method to high pressure experiments. It has been applied to calibrate a majorite, a new majorite geobarometer here at the geophysical lab, to the correction of iron magnesium exchange thermometers, and to a new oxybarometer for eclogites. And there's also a new application on glasses. We also apply the Flank method to natural rocks, especially to zoned garnets, who are a perfect object to investigate with the Flank method because of the high resolution of an electron microprobe to determine ferric iron, and at the same time being able to carry out quantitative analyses. This is just a refreshment of what happens in an electron microprobe if an electron beam hits a sample. The electrons are scattered within the sample. As they travel through the sample, they lose energy and they stop eventually, depending on the high voltage which you are using. For a garnet, an almandine, for instance, the penetration depth at 20 kV is about 2.5 microns. We exploit the characteristic X-ray emission for ferric iron determination and also for quantitative analysis. The other effects on the left side are only used for surface imaging. So what happens in the sample? If a primary electron in the atom is actually, if a primary electron hits an iron atom, electrons are ejected from inner cores parts, and a vacancy is created. Electrons relax from outer orbitals into this vacancy. In the case of a vacancy in the K level, it's iron K emission that we get, and this is what we use usually for elemental analysis. In the case of a vacancy in the L level, we get iron L X-ray emission. Important to note is that the electrons involved in this L emission are, in the case of iron, bonding electrons. They are part of the chemical bonding. So what is different in conventional and in ferric iron determination by electron microprobe? In conventional analysis, elemental analysis, we use characteristic X-rays which are produced by inner shell ionizations. It is iron K-alpha lines, for instance. They are high energy X-rays. For ferric iron, determination, we use X-rays, characteristic X-rays also, but they are produced by transitions involving bonding electrons, and it's the RNL alpha and the RNL beta lines. These are low energy soft X-rays. The principle and the reason why we use the RNL lines is that there is a chemical shift and an intensity variation of RNL alpha and L beta with ferric ion content. The problem is that the RNL spectra are also influenced by matrix effects, such as the coordination polyhedra, the crystal structure itself, the chemical composition, especially the iron content, which leads to self-absorption. For the Flank method, we calibrate, therefore, with for one structure type only, that's garnet. We measure the L beta to L alpha ratios off peak relative to on peak. This leads to a sensitivity improvement, a substantial sensitivity improvement. And we correct empirically for the iron content, that is for self-absorption. And this leads to accurate determination of ferric of the ferric to ferrous iron ratio. No? Here we see the RNL emission spectra of almandine and androdite. So intensity versus energy. The peak position of almandine, that is the iron, the ferrous iron containing end member, is shifted towards higher energies as the ferric iron content increases. So this is for androdite. We can also see that the peak intensities change, as for instance, here in androdite, the L beta peak is much lower in relation to L alpha. So there are different ways of exploiting this behavior for ferric iron determination. One would be to measure the intensities at the peak maximum and take the ratio L beta to L alpha, for instance, or to measure the peak area, calculate the ratio. For the Flank method, we do intensity measurements at exactly two positions off the peak, where the difference between the garnets which contain only iron 2 plus or iron 3 plus are most pronounced. We find this position by calculating the difference, the simple difference of the intensities of the androdite and almandine spectra, and what we get is this position for the L alpha measurement, it's this maximum, and at this minimum of the different spectrum, we put the, we take the L beta position. By doing this, we get both informations into the ratio L beta to L alpha, the information of the peak shift, as well as the information of the change in intensity. And this enhances sensitivity substantially. In this diagram, the ratio L beta to L alpha, it didn't get the, it didn't get the Greek letters here. L beta to L alpha versus ferric to total iron is plotted for the various evaluation methods. We looked at many different solid solution systems. The blue triangles are literature data. The overall change in intensity ratio at the peak maximum is very small from androdite to pyrope almandine bearing samples. As you can see here, and also there is a very small, or there is practically a problem to correlate the L beta to L alpha ratio to the ferric iron content. Cannot clearly be correlated. The if we take the peak area method, it does not substantially improve the whole thing. The change is similar. With the Flank method, we have a much higher change between androdite and almandine, but the system androdite skiagite, which is the pure iron 2 plus iron 3 plus garnet, has a different slope from the system skiagite almandine. And we have also some pyrope almandines which plot here at 0 iron 3 plus and show a result that is as ambiguous as what we had before with the peak maximum method. To understand these seeming ambiguities, we now need to look at the effect of self-absorption. For this, we measured emission spectra at conditions of relatively low self-absorption, which is 2.5 kilovolts accelerating voltage, and at relatively high self-absorption, which is 10 kilovolts. And then we calculated the self-absorption spectrum. You can do that by simply dividing the intensities at 2.5 and 10 kV and taking the natural logarithm. The result is plotted here for almandine and androdite. As we can see, there is an absorption edge, mostly clear in the regions where the Planck method measuring positions are, most clearly at the iron L alpha spectrometer position. And it shows that the absorption edge changes with, if you look at this, changes with ferric to total iron content. So the emission also changes. What happens in the atoms? We also lost some. This would be L alpha, this would be L beta. We see here the energy level, electron energy level diagram of metallic iron in the middle. It has the argon configuration plus 8 electrons. And we see the crystal field splitting of the 3D electronic levels in for iron 2 plus in dodecahedral coordination. For emission, I have shown that we have transitions, electron transitions from outer levels to vacancies in the L level. The absorption process is roughly the opposite. It's electrons are ejected from the L levels to higher energy levels, or the atom is completely ionized. The important thing about this is to realize that the emission and absorption energies are relatively close to each other. And also that there is a theoretical ratio of L beta to L alpha of 0.5, which is due to the electron occupancy of the L2 and L3 levels, which is 2 and 4. To show what happens in the sample, I did some Monte Carlo simulations to show the electron trajectories for almandine at accelerating voltages between 2.5 and 20 kV. If this is the sample surface, the electron beam hits the sample at 2.5 kV. It's very little penetration, of course. Penetration increases with increasing accelerating voltage or energy of the electrons, and we come to some depth of 2.5 microns, roughly at 20 kV. Now, if we put this together, we get this picture where we see that X-ray emission is created within this volume, and self-absorption takes place on the path of the X-rays to the detector. So one could argue, first of all, if self-absorption is important for the Planck method, then increasing the energy should lead to longer path lengths and to higher self-absorption. So this should be good for, or a positive effect for, the Planck method. But in fact, if you do a Monte Carlo simulation to see how the emission volume looks, or the emission depth looks like for iron L emission, then you see the iron L emission is so soft, so low energy, that the X-ray photons are absorbed by the matrix, especially by the iron atoms, due to self-absorption, and they cannot escape from a greater depth than roughly 1 micron, 0.8 microns, actually, which is the value of penetration depth between 10 and 15 kV. So increasing the accelerating voltage to 20 kV does not increase the analyzed volume for ferric iron determination anymore. It also shows us that actually the volume which is used for ferric iron determination is very small, much smaller than compared to any other method for ferric iron determination. So we have a very high resolution of ferric iron with the electron microprobe. This diagram where the ratio L beta to L alpha is plotted versus accelerating LNG shows exactly the fact that we are reaching the maximum emission depth of the iron L lines. If we look at the data at 2.5, the ratio at 2.5 kV accelerating voltage, almandine and androlite are practically the same, have practically the same value, which is close to the theoretical value of 0.5. The value for androlite stays practically the same, while the ratio for almandine increases strongly until 15 kV, where it reaches a plateau practically. So the effect of self-absorption shows us that the ratio it increases the sensitivity of the flank method in this case. Looking at the same ratio versus total iron for different garnets, for four different garnets with completely different total garnet contents and at different accelerating voltages, gives us the same ratio roughly of close to the theoretical value of 0.5 for all the different garnets at 2.5 kV. That's the low self-absorption condition. And as soon as we increase the accelerating voltage, those garnets which contain ferrous iron show a higher ratio, which increases at 15 kV but stays the same at 20 kV. It's the same effect. We reach the maximum emission depth, so 15 and 20 kV give the same result. So we learn from this that the self-absorption is the most important effect for the flank method, and also that 15 kV is an optimum accelerating voltage to work at for the flank method. It gives the highest sensitivity and the maximum sampling volume is already reached. This is just to remind you of the ambiguous results which we got for the ratio L beta to L alpha when we plotted it versus ferric to total iron content before. We now plot these data versus total iron and not versus ferric to total iron. And we get these results with synthetic garnets. We analyze many different synthetic garnet solid solution series, almandine solid solutions with pyrope, spessartine, knorringite, grossular, almandine skiagite, pure iron 2 and 3 garnet, and androdite grossular also. The garnets, the results align according to the substitutions that occur. So the garnets which align here along line number 1 contain hardly no iron 3 plus, and substitution takes place on the dodecahedral side of the garnet structure where the divalent cations are exchanged by iron 2 plus. If we look at line number 2, then the iron 2 content in the performula unit stays constant because the dodecahedral sides are completely filled with iron 2 plus, and substitution takes only place on the octahedral sides. Between skiagite and androdite, we have a completely filled octahedral side filled with iron 3 plus, and substitution of iron 2 plus is substituted by calcium. And in the grossular androdites, we have no ferric iron, and the substitution again takes place on the octahedral side. So the systematics behind this is that in these garnets number one, line number one and three, the replacement, the substitution only occurs on dodecahedral sites, while in along line number two and number four, the substitution occurs on the octahedral site. We also see that the lines number one and three are parallel to each other, which led us to plot these data against ferrous iron, iron 2 plus, hopla. And we see that all the different garnet solid solution systems align along a well-defined line with their L beta to L alpha Planck method ratio. This is produced by self-absorption. So now this led us to formulate an empirical equation to correct for self-absorption for the ferric iron determination. And we did a two-dimensional linear regression, since the ferric iron content not only depends on L beta to L alpha, but also on total iron. So we formulate this equation where ferric iron depends on L beta to L alpha, total iron, and a mixed term. And we get these numbers, which is the calibration for the synthetic garnets that we had. This diagram shows the garnets which we took for the calibration. L beta to L alpha is plotted versus total iron content. And the result of the equation I have just shown, with the result we can calculate lines for equal iron 3 to total iron, which spread out at higher total iron content, and they meet at a point at zero total iron, which is close to the theoretical value of 0.5. Now, we want to look at mantle garnets, for instance, with low iron 3 plus, with low total iron, which lie within this compositional within this range. And as we see, there may be a larger error due to the fact that the equilines come very close to each other. So what we should do is to calibrate with samples which have a similar total iron content and also a similar ferric to total iron content. This is what we did, and the result is this diagram where we compare the iron 3 to total iron as determined by the Planck method to the Messbauer values. We calibrated with four standards, natural standards with a quite wide field of total iron content given here between approximately 5 and 21 weight percent, and a very small range of iron 3 to total iron between 0.03 and 0.13 here. As we can see, the errors are much smaller than the ones we would get if we only calibrated with the synthetic garnets. The errors with the natural garnet standardization calibration are as with Messbauer spectroscopy. Let us summarize what we learned about the Frank method. Iron 3 to total iron can be determined in garnet with low total iron, like in mantle garnets, and low iron 3 to total iron, with the same accuracy as by Messbauer spectroscopy, provided that well-characterized garnet standards with a similar compositional range are used. The big advantage is the high spatial resolution of an electron microprobe combined with the possibility of simultaneous elemental analysis. We now come to the applications of the Planck method. It has been applied to a number of high pressure, high temperature experiments. The effect of iron 3 plus on majorette geobarometry and on iron magnesium exchange thermometry has been investigated. It has been applied to the calibration of a new oxybarometer for eclogites and to the oxidation state of iron in natural and synthetic glasses. For the application in natural rocks, we especially focus on zoned garnets, and we measured the oxygen fugacity of a percolating metasomatic mouth in a polymict mantle breccia, and the change of oxygen fugacity during metamorphism and fluid rock interaction. This is the first application of a Flank method to experiments. It's a work, experimental work by Renbian, Yingwei, Emma Bullock, and co-workers. From the geophysical lab, they already have the paper and press at GCA. They realized that existing majorite substitution barometers do not take iron 3 plus into account, and therefore pressures of formation are underestimated in natural majoritic garnets. So they experimentally calibrated a new barometer for iron 3 plus bearing majoritic garnets and tested it to existing barometers on their experiments. The backscattered electron image shows an experimental charge with a majorite crystal here, has a size of about 30 microns. And 3 plus has been determined with the Flank method at a geophysical lab. The majorite compositions plot in this triangular diagram with a large pyrope component and a smaller knorringite component. And iron 3 plus is given by the skier guide. There's the substantial iron 3 plus is given by the skier guide and andradite components. The newly calibrated geobarometer reproduces the experimental pressure very well, with the largest deviation at 0.7 GPa, while all the literature data underestimate the experimental pressure. This diagram shows the difference between the experimental pressure minus the calculated pressure. So the largest difference is at 5 GPa is at 14 GPa with the Beyer and Frost barometer. The second application is our study of the influence of iron 3 plus on iron 2 plus magnesium exchange thermometry, a work that has been done by two of our master students, Vladimir Matyushkin and Caroline Höfer. The problem with the existing geothermometers is that if they do not account for the iron 3 plus substitution in garnet, the calculated formation temperatures are underestimated. So the measurement of iron 3 plus in garnet allows us to correct the distribution coefficient. The experimental work was done in a belt apparatus in Frankfurt, in the rhenium-like platinum capsules. As starting materials, we used pyridotite mixtures from minerals and oxides with and without iron 3 plus for reversal experiments, as we can see here by the green and red colors. And one experiment was done with a more oxidizing manganese oxide, manganese MN304 buffer. The electron image here shows the peridotitic mineral assemblage and the size of the garnets that are about 10 microns large. We did the ferric iron determination with the Flank method on them. The garnet OPX geothermometer of Harley is based on the distribution of iron and magnesium and garnet and also pyroxene. So the distribution coefficient becomes too high if you do not account for iron 3 plus, but if it's present. The reason is iron 3 only goes into the garnet, and then the distribution coefficient is too high, and we get too low temperatures. We underestimate the temperature that we can see, what we can see here in this diagram, where the temperature as calculated with the Hawley thermometer minus the experimental temperature is shown versus experimental temperature. The underestimation increases with increasing temperature and is over 200 degrees at 1400 degrees C. If we now correct for the iron 3 plus content by measuring it with the Planck method, we yield the right diagram and the temperatures are very well corrected now. Yes? No. No, you would need to take some garnets which have a more similar composition to this. Yes, that's certainly a question which one should look at. Yeah. So now we come to the garnet olivine thermometer of O'Neill and Wood, which also underestimates the temperature substantially if we do not account for iron 3 plus in the garnet, for the same reason as the Hawley thermometer. We see the large deviation here to the left, and the correction of the thermometer calculation to the right if we correct for iron 3 plus content. It is also most notably that the one experiment with the manganese buffer, which is very oxidizing and gives the largest deviation of 400 degrees if we do not correct for iron 3 plus, comes to a value within the experiment, within the error of the thermometer, the uncertainty of the thermometer here, and is well corrected for. So we conclude that the geothermometers of Hawley and O'Neill and Wood can be used very well to correct temperatures, to give the correct temperatures if iron 3 plus is taken into account. A further application is in collaboration with Prok Vasiliev, who experimentally calibrated a new oxybarometer for kyanite eclogites in the course of his PhD thesis at ANU in Canberra. Basing on these two equations, these end members components in CPX, Hindenburg and CPX, plus Grosser Molar component in garnet in equilibrium with andradite and almonine components in garnet and coesite, and Grosser-Molar almonine components in equilibrium with andradite component and kyanite plus coesite. The backscattered image shows the result of one of his experiments. The garnets are very small, like 3 or 4 microns in size. We analyzed them for iron 3 plus by the Planck method in Frankfurt. Prok used noble metal sensors to monitor the oxygen fugacity and to show or to cross-check the calculations of his new barometer. He plotted the result of the log of the oxygen fugacity as calculated from reaction 2 versus the oxygen fugacity as that he calculated from reaction 1, and it gives excellent agreement. The last application I'm showing for experiments is a collaboration with a group in Hannover. They submitted their paper to American mineralogists, and its first round of revision asked for minor changes, so it will be published soon, hopefully. The NOFA group tested 43 synthetic and natural silicate glasses with iron 2 plus to total iron known from wet chemistry, and the total FeO content between 4 and 18 weight percent. In the left diagram here, we see the Planck method ratio L beta to L alpha versus ferrous iron content. All kinds of different glasses, natural, synthetic, and also hydrous glasses, plot on a line between androdite and almandine. The iron 2 to total iron content in the right diagram, as determined by the Planck method, is compared here to wet chemistry, and the results plot well along the 1-to-1 line within the dotted lines, which represent an error of 0.1 in ferrous to total iron. So now we come to the applications of the Planck method to natural rocks. We investigated a veined polemic breccia from Bossov Road diamond mine dump in Kimberley. We see here the greenish part of the breccia, of the peridotitic breccia, which is intersected by veins which contain ilmenite and clinopyroxene megacrysts with orthopyroxene and garnet in the matrix that precipitated from the metasomatizing melt. This is a polished section of the rock that shows the veins. Here, Granny Smith CPX, which is partially dissolved in reaction with OPX, ilmenite megacrysts, and OPX and garnet matrix. The breccia itself contains, is inhomogeneous, contains olivine, OPX, garnet, xenocrysts. The CPX are partially dissolved and overgrown with OPX. And the breccia, all the breccia parts stem from fractured peridotites and more rarely from eclogites. If we look more closely at this breccia part, we see garnets of different colors. These more pinkish, reddish garnets are peridotitic with different compositions. And the more orangey garnets, eclogitic. They're all overgrown with a new garnet, newly formed garnet of the same composition. And the OPX xenocrysts are also overgrown with OPX of same composition. The olivine is partly serpentinized. From this, we determined nickel with the nickel and garnet thermometer from the xenoliths, we determined the temperatures, which range between roughly 1,000 and 1,300 degrees C. And if we look at the Kimberley geotherm and project them on the Kimberley geotherm of 42 millivolts per square meter, we find the largest depth at 200 kilometers, which would be the minimum depth where the brecciation began and the transporting kimberlite originated. The breccia sampled fractured peridotites and also eclogites over a range of about 80 kilometers, a depth range. The overgrowth of garnet, OPX, and olivine are in some places in contact with each other, so equilibrium amongst them can be assumed, from which we can calculate the solidification conditions of the breccia at 3.5 GPa and 1150 degrees centigrade, which corresponds to a depth of about 110 kilometers. We analyzed the overgrowth and the and two of the xenoliths with the Planck method and get iron 3 to total iron contents of 0.083 to 0.127. We calculated from the minerals in equilibrium, we calibrated the oxygen fugacity and plotted relative to FMQ in a diagram versus depth. There exists some data about Kimberley xenoliths from Rudin and Koch, which show a trend to decreasing oxygen fugacity with increasing depth, and our xenoliths follow this trend. The overgrowths have a higher show a higher oxygen fugacity as the most shallow parts of the Kimberley xenoliths here at the same depth, and indicate that the magma was the percolating melt was more oxidizing. What happened? Okay. More oxidizing. The solidification occurred very rapid. Due to the fact that the breccia was hotter than the surrounding peridotite. Here are some applications to zone garnets, which are a perfect object for analyzing with the Planck method. This work by Renbiao from here, from Geophysical Lab, by Renbiao and Yingwei and co-workers, is on the formation of abiotic hydrocarbon from reduction of carbonates in the Tian Shan subduction zone in China. The iron 3, the reduction process was documented by the iron 3 determination in the zone garnets, which I did in Frankfurt. Another application to zone garnets is on manganese-rich metasediments from the high-pressure, low-temperature metamorphic belt in the Chilean Suzhou zone in China. It's a collaboration of Frankfurt with several co-workers in Peking University. And during the last weeks, we have carried out many Planck method measurements on these extremely zoned garnets. So the data I'm showing are practically still hot from the electron beam. And they show the, I will take them as an example also for showing the strength of the Planck method as being, as having the high resolution of an electron microprobe and with the possibility of determining ferric iron and the total iron, or the quantitative elemental analysis at the same time. So here we see the backscattered electron image of such a manganese-rich sediment. It mainly consists of garnet, and some albite and some apatite are also present. The garnets are strongly zoned and fractured. They have light cores here and dark rims and some oscillatory zoning, which you can't really see now in between. The dark rims and the overgrowths here on fractured garnets and also in channels like these ones are the same, and they seem to be associated with the albite in these channels. So some albite-rich melt or fluid must have entered this rock in a late stage. We now look a little bit closer at this garnet here. This is the backscattered image, again, together with elemental maps of manganese, aluminum, and iron. We see the small, relatively small core surrounded by a relatively homogeneous, more or less homogeneous region until we see this heavily zoned region, and the rim part, which is about 50 microns wide. We analyzed this garnet with the Planck method along a line from over the core, across the core, to the rim in steps of 12 microns approximately. The results are shown here. These are the measuring areas of the Planck method. This is the dark rim on the right side. And above here, you see the iron 3 to total iron content. Each data point here is an average of 25 single measurements, which I did in a grid of 5 times 5 micron. The quantitative data down here still show each single measurement. But this is the average. So what we see is the strong zonation in manganese from core to rim, aluminum, iron, given as total FeO, and calcium and also magnesium. The core here is fully oxidized, as we see from the ratio 1 of iron 3 to iron total iron. We also find some hematite sometimes in the cores. Then iron 3 plus 2 total iron decreases. It jumps suddenly to a higher value of 0.9 here. Although the chemical composition does not show large changes here, the ferric iron content does change a lot. And in the heavily zoned part here, it decreases, while the main elements show some variation, especially the iron increases substantially. And when we reach the rim, the iron 3 plus content drops abruptly to a very low value of 0.1, while other elements also show large variations. What we can see is that iron 3 is negatively correlated with aluminum, which expresses the relative changes of the grossulane and rhodite component. And we are still in progress of finding a genetic model for all this, but we can say already that progressive metamorphism and fluid interaction is accompanied by a fluctuation of oxygen fugacity with a strong decrease at the final stage. Yeah. Okay, in summary, we have seen that the Planck method allows the unambiguous iron 3 iron 2 total iron determination in garnets with very low total iron content, like in mantle garnet at low iron 3 to total iron contents also, with the same accuracy as Masbauer spectroscopy. This opens a large field of applications to high pressure, high temperature work, and also to natural rocks, especially to zoned garnets. I would like to thank all these people for their help, advice, discussions, collaboration, and especially also for supplying me with synthetic and natural samples. And first of all, I would like to thank Gerhard Brey, who had the idea of a project to measure iron 3 plus with the electron microprobe when I started to work with him, and for his support since then. I especially also would like to ask to thank Catherine McGammon for Mössbauer milliprobe analyses. And with this high pressure capsule, I would like to thank you for this, your attention. Thank you. Good question. It depends on how strong the crystal structure may influence the ratio. One really would need to have some reference. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. If you are able to prepare to experimentally prepare some different iron concentrations and iron three concentrations, I think this should be possible. I have looked at many different mineral structures also to see whether there is the same systematics. Yeah, and you can really see it in all kinds of. Maybe you can show this quickly. The mouse is here. Okay, let me see. Oh, it's exactly the next. I could have done it like this. Yeah. So it is. Yeah. If we plot the iron, the ratio, the flank method ratio in this case, L beta to L alpha to versus ferric iron, many different crystal structures plot along lines. Yeah, but I think, well, this work has been done on many different microprobes, so it's kind of, you have to be careful, but I'm quite sure that also working on the same microprobe, you get the highest values for the garnet and lower values for pyroxenes or ferropericlase, like the thing Catherine McCammon made or looked at. And the smaller the coordination number, the smaller the overall change practically is. So sensitivity goes a little bit down. But in principle, it should be possible, I think. On flank method, on? Ah, on glasses.
Yeah.
Is there any
matrix
effect? Yeah, actually, I was quite surprised that their data are on a line between andradite and almandine, because this exactly is not what I'm saying here. I don't think the ferrous iron is in dodecahedral surrounding in the glasses, so it's really interesting to see that they lie on one line. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it seems to be. It seems to work quite well, actually. Yeah, that's what I've seen. It really works well. I don't know why, actually, because the coordination number of the iron in the glass is maybe 5 or 6 or something, but not 8. Yeah, but it works.
So for this particular, there's lots of different kind of composition of glass. Have you looked at the literature and the other data and similar components? So what you're saying is that here you don't really see a metric effect.
No, don't really see a metrics effect. Yeah.
That's actually Bob has some good questions in terms of this meteorite substitutions.
Mm-hmm.
So, the question is whether those small substitutions has the right sensitivity.
Yeah.
And the other things that we find is also where those high ferric iron content is not as sensitive as it can be, even if you do a very good probe analysis, the charge balances.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really come down to when you've
is more helpful at low iron concentrations. I also have that feeling that if you have high iron concentrations, doing a good silicon determination on a garnet is not so easy. Then you get large errors with the stoichiometry. But probably at high oxygen or at the high ferric iron contents and at high total iron contents, maybe it's not so bad also.
Yeah, yeah.
One should look at that. What you really need, and that's one of my problems with the zoned garnets from Chilean, that I had all of a sudden I had completely oxidized garnet next to very reduced garnet, and I had the problem of which standards am I going to take? And actually, I only took one andradite for the oxidized ones, and it worked quite well actually. I also took sphiergite, but sometimes it was not possible because of measuring time. Yeah, we had to change samples. I have my sphiergite on a different holder. Yeah, it's just profane reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But taking just the andradite was good enough also. But you get larger errors, and especially because these have such little iron contents. They're completely oxidized, but very low iron contents.
Yeah.
That makes it difficult.
Yeah.
We need some standards, actually, with such composition. That would be good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Yeah. We actually, myself and, do you know Annette von der Hans?
Mm-hmm.
And John Fornell and Tim Rose at the Smithsonian actually started going through the Smithsonian collections looking for new standard materials, and one of the things Annette was really looking for was garnets with a variety of composition.
Yeah.
Of all, having good garnet standards, and then having enough that we can distribute it to different labs.
Yeah.
So we have some candidates that
mm-hmm.
we think
mm-hmm.
might actually prove to be good garnet standards. So we're planning on preparing a series of mineral mounts
mm-hmm.
and actually sending them to different labs
mm-hmm.
so that everyone can get analyses
mm-hmm.
and we'll compare and see if
good.
The garnets, if they're homogeneous and if different labs are getting the same numbers.
Yes,
hopefully.
Most
so
important.
So
that's good.
That's on our list of things. We're hoping to present something at M&M this
mm-hmm.
year about
mm-hmm.
it. So
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Yes, I'm also looking for garnets which we can use as
yes.
standards for iron 3+.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, if the Smithsonian has anything in their collections,
mm-hmm.
then it's perfect because it's free. You just request it. So
yes, that's true.
Even better.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is there a plan for lunch?
Yeah, yeah. So
okay, are there sandwiches and things there? Okay. So. Making sure there's a lunch so I don't disappear. Perfect. Yeah. No, this is amazing work. Like before I came here and before you introduced me to this, I had no idea that you could do this on the microprobe.
It's
amazing.
Special.
It is super special.
People has
to
be, kind of really spend the time to do it, right? I mean, obviously, it's like total work. You don't do systematic preparations, always get a lot of scattering. That's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there were a lot of attempts to do it before I started to work on it, of
mm-hmm.
course. But the problem was the people were taking some natural garnets with
mm-hmm.
a very narrow range in compositions, and
mm-hmm.
they were not able to see these systematic variances.
Yeah.
My luck was that I really collected so many different synthetic garnets
mm-hmm.
to be able to see there is some systematics behind it. Otherwise,
mm-hmm.
I never would have realized.
Yeah.
And from this, it can go on then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was going to ask if you've been working with Eri Hughes as well. I met her last year, I think, at EMAS in Konstanz, and she's wonderful.
Yes.
I love Eri, so I'm really excited to see that she's getting this to work in glasses.
I don't know her personally, actually.
As well.
For the last garnet, you showed from the shooting. So that one, is
mm-hmm.
there any possibility to measure the manganese? 3+ and 2+. No. Yeah,
oh,
this one.
This one.
So you measure the iron 3+, right?
Yeah.
So how about
mm-hmm.
the manganese?
Manganese. 3+. Yes, we thought about that. You mean whether you can do it with a flat method?
Yeah.
Or whether there is any
at
all? Well, I don't think there is. There could be some. We looked at it for the we looked at the quantitative measurements, and it doesn't look as if there were some manganese free in there.
Okay.
Yeah, but in principle, doing Planck method on other elements is possible.
I was wondering
about
titanium. I mean,
yes, but you need the standard.
Yeah, yeah,
that's the problem.
Yeah. I can see that.
But if you want to do it, I looked at many, or other people looked at many, and published this,
mm-hmm.
at many different compositions or many different crystals,
mm-hmm.
Minerals with different crystal structure, and if you plot it versus iron 2+, you see that there is some systematic, but usually
mm-hmm.
they measured the intensity ratio at the maximum, and the sensitivity is not as large.
Yeah.
But
you know,
see,
I mean,
this
is actually
mm-hmm.
interesting. I mean, if I looked at this as like the core, I would probably define the much larger, right? I mean, you are seeing some ferric ion content.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you didn't measure the ferric,
mm-hmm.
I'm still
you
a little bit.
You think this is the core. Huh?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this is certainly consistent with the manganese content being kind of. I mean, even for the ferric ion, I don't think the disturbance in maybe start. Much later, you see a much more. I mean, this is still representing pretty high ferric ion content, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the core
mm-hmm.
itself. It's
yep.
just some oscillations.
We had some, in this garnet, but in another garnet I found it.
Yeah.
We did. Yeah. You know these samples?
Yeah.
yeah.
I worked for a while.
Peking
yeah.
University.
yeah.
So
we are from him group.
Shitting was in my lab.
We are from him group.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Li Fei Chang, of course.
Yeah.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and it's amazing. Actually.
So that's the first garnet that you have a kind of looked at system. Have you looked at any other? I mean, it looks like a several of those cores, right?
I looked at the second one, but we did not evaluate it yet. I didn't have time to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I do have a second line in this one where I tried out because I somehow got upset because, I mean, here you could think, well, this here, I just
mm-hmm.
hit the side.
So close. You said these are grids of.
Maybe there is some iron. Maybe this is also reused.
Yeah,
I cannot really tell from
this. Hint of it
yeah.
there. There's
so
a hint of
but
it.
But
yeah.
What I did is, it's somewhere far in the end here. There. I did a second line. So the one line which we have seen is number one here, and the
mm-hmm.
second line is there. And I increased the measurement time for L alpha and L beta to 300 seconds. It's
mm-hmm.
140 here. To get a little bit better counting statistics. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
But it still is not so good.
Mm-hmm.
But what I actually see, although this is here, but you still see this ribbon, this second dark
mm-hmm.
ribbon here. And we really measure over it, yeah, and it's not reduced. It's definitely not really. I mean, the scatter, the errors are larger because I only have one measurement, not 25.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still clear that it's not reduced.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
You see here the error is very small.
Yeah.
That's a re-equilibrium.
Sorry?
I mean, that may be re-equilibrium at a later stage.
Yeah. Actually, it's just a matter of composition.
Yeah.
The color is dark.
Because
you get a little
you have air bed,
and you get a
air
lot
bed
of iron,
in
and it's just a chemical,
mm-hmm.
but not a ferric iron reason
mm-hmm.
for this. So that's quite interesting. But you do see this jump here. You do see this jump again, like here.
Yeah. Yeah, which isn't really reflected in the backscatter.
No.
It, I mean, if
not
I was just looking at that grain, not in the composition,
you don't
I would
see
say,
it.
No,
yep.
That is.
It's quite funny.
Yeah.
It's quite interesting to see, to look at this. I mean, it took
yes.
a long measuring time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It tells a different story than if you just look at the quantitative measurements, the elemental measurements.
So these on the left are averages of 25 points. You did a 5x5 grids.
Yeah, that's
okay.
what I usually do just to get a better counting statistic.
Mm-hmm.
Smaller error.
Okay. What is the spacing on the grid? I'm looking for the spatial
it's just
resolution.
1 micron.
1 micron, okay.
By 1 micron.
So you're still getting spatial 1. Resolution?
2, the step is 1.2.
Yeah.
Okay, you have a good
micron.
Stage.
Yeah.
You can
yes,
just point,
it is.
Point
it's
something
really
of a micron.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It's
good.
Pressure for this sample should be around 2.5, right?
I don't know.
Okay.
could be,
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Includes that feces.
Thank you,
yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
This is Doug Rambo.
I enjoyed your talk very much.
Yeah.
I used one of these things first in 1965.
Really?
So we talked a lot about ferric ferrous. Good for you.
Mm-hmm.
Good for you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the machines weren't very good, did they?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We're very. I feel very lucky that I get to play with a nice new probe. Yeah.
Yeah. Now you have probably you also have larger crystals. TAP.
Yeah. Oh, so this is a whole thing. So we did try. So we have the large crystal for the LIF and the PET. We tried the large area TAP crystal, and we actually tried 8 different ones. All of them had issues. There's some problem. The TAP crystal, when they have the bigger crystal, they just cannot bend it enough without it cracking. It looks perfect when you put it in, and the second you put it under vacuum, it fractures. And so we were getting very uneven peak shapes. We just could not get a nice symmetrical peak. So John Armstrong was going to present about this at M&M, and JEOL did not want that. And, and then
yeah,
John retired and all the problems went away.
Oh,
we spent several months changing it. I mean, the poor engineer could take apart the spectrometer like with a blindfold on by the end of like 6 months of spectrometer apart, spectrometer back together. He was an expert at putting the crystals in. The TAP H just did not work.
Yeah.
It just did not work. So we were very lucky that JEOL worked with us, and because we wanted we had the LDE6H as well,
mm-hmm.
for carbon. So we were like, this is perfect. We have the high resolution for the carbon, the TAP crystal be high resolution. No, it just didn't work. We had to get rid of it.
Do you know somebody where it works?
Not really, no.
Uh-oh.
I know.
What
looking I think there are labs that have it, but maybe they're not pushing so much to check how good quality the data is in terms of the peak shapes they're obtaining or the reproducibility. It's good enough for what they need it to do. But yeah, we had John really pushing whether the crystal was going to work for us or not, and it didn't. It was funny, some of the crystals that cracked were actually better than some of the crystals that didn't crack. It's the strangest thing. Some of the crystals, we took them out and they'd have a crack at one edge, and they'd
so
be
really
terrible.
You could see it.
You could, I mean, you could physically see it when you held the crystal up. You could see it
because
the crack was so big. So we'd put them in, they'd be perfect. We'd pump the probe down, and that was it. They'd just crack. So still holding out for the perfect Tap H, but we didn't get of the, I think it was 7 or 8, I think it was 8 that we tried, none of them matched specification. Sad, very sad.
Hmm.
Yeah.
That's
so
sad. I go and cry.
Yes, there was a lot of crying in the probe lab. There was a lot of crying.
We're going to have some lunch in next door.
Okay.
See what sandwiches we have today. I hope I'm holding up for the desserts, the little pots of desserts.
But it works. Yeah, well,
really?
We'll see. But they move the stage somewhere. See here? To one of another one. So
okay.
Somebody who sees that should shout at me and say, "This is nonsense." Because it's also on alkali bearing glasses. But they move the stage. It's homogeneous glass, so you don't need that high spatial resolution. And they move the stage while they are measuring. You can do that with a Kamaka stage.
Oh, yeah, you mean the critical point? When
the point is moved on the sample.
After one measurement, go to another.
It continuously moves, I think, with a speed of.
You mean during the measurement?
During the measurement.
During
the measurement. Yeah.
It's a Cessna.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what they do.
Okay.
And it they did a lot of measurements on the beam damage, of course.
Yeah.
It's natural.
And
it is really, there's no beam damage. Hmm?
So those glasses have a different combination.
Yeah, this.
Yeah?
Alkali bearing, I have a picture which shows more details, but.
I want to know more detail about the
Zhang Chao. It's the first really systematic work on glasses, and they have very good glasses, so they can really do it. It's very good.
Yeah.
We'll be an American mineralogist soon. Cool. That's quite cool. At least it shows that I don't know why it plots between almondine and andrelat. That's funny, but it does. For some reason it does.
They have him
called a Kamaka? No, not at all.
So yeah, next day, so the, I mean, all the different coordination number, they have different slope, right? Like that.
Yeah.
So for the glasses, maybe they have.
Maybe the slope difference is not as.
Yeah.